Okay.
As our show begins, a young girl is exploring her grandfather's photo album, the Berlin Airlift, in which he was a pilot. As she does, he reflects on his memories, and his recollections spring to life on our stage.
Thank you.
What's this?
These pictures of something I was part of many years ago, before your mom and dad were even born. It was called Berlin Airlift. It's a long story. Would you like to hear about it?
Yes.
Okay. It was Germany after World War II. The country had been through a lot, about 6 years of war. There was a lot of damage. Buildings and the economy were in rubble, and there was a lot of pain. People were trying to understand, trying to get their lives back together again. It wasn't easy, but they were determined. Germany was still occupied by the Allies, The country was split into four zones. You can see on this old map. The Soviets occupied the eastern zone. The British were up north, the French in the west, and we had some of the center and south. But Berlin was special. It was in the middle of the Soviet zone, but like the country itself, it was divided into four sectors. Now, I know it seems hard to believe now, but we just fought each other in a long, hard war. Once it was over, we slowly began to get to know each other as people. Little things helped. Talking to kids, sharing a candy bar. And one way we got to know each other was through music. It was the era of the big bands and jazz. We loved to listen to our recordings of those big bands. And the Germans enjoyed them too.
Britain and France wanted to help Germany economically, but were determined that what the Red Army had conquered, the Red Army would rule. See that man there? That's Joseph Stalin, Uncle Joe, some people used to call him. But he wasn't family, he was the Soviet dictator, and he wouldn't cooperate with efforts to help Germany. So the US, Britain, and France went ahead without him. They made plans to merge their three zones into one West Germany. The first step was the creation of the Deutschmark. It took effect on June 20th. Stalin didn't like that. 4 days later, he turned out the lights on Berlin and slammed the door.
At Kommandantura headquarters in Berlin, the Cold War reaches a new crisis. The Reds haul in their flag and refuse to cooperate with the Allies who have helped rule Germany ever since the war's end. Instead, they roll in tanks and troops and effectively cut off all access to West Berlin and the 2.5 million people trapped within its borders. As Red troops encircle the city, they take no pains to disguise the fact they want the Allies out of Berlin. The Soviets close off all roads. Trains are stopped for so-called technical reasons. Barges find waterways closed to them. Highways are barren and deserted. The goal of the Soviets, to force the Allies out of Berlin and starve the West Berliners into submission. More than 300,000 Berliners pledge their support to the Western Allies at a rally. The Allies exert their claims to West Berlin.
We have a right to be in Berlin, and we intend to maintain that right.
But how can the Allies succeed without power for factories, coal for heat, and food to feed the masses? How can the West Berliners possibly survive this blockade? With thousands of Red troops poised just over the border, and West Berlin blockaded from Allied aid, a world of freedom-loving people anxiously awaits the outcome of this crisis.
General LeMay's office. Just a minute, sir. General LeMay, General Clay's office calling.
General LeMay.
Kurt, the Reds got us between a rock and a hard place with this move to cut off Berlin. If we give in, Berlin disappears behind the Iron Curtain. Now that's a disaster for Berlin and a disaster for us. It cuts the credibility out from under General Marshall's plan to help Europe rebuild. But I've talked to Washington. There's no stomach for forcing the blockade. They think if we send tanks up the Autobahn, it might mean World War III. And even if they were willing to risk that, we don't have enough troops in Europe to follow through. They're looking for options. What can you do?
Well, sir, the three air corridors are still open. We're flying in food for the garrisons. We could step that up, flying some food for the Berliners. I understand they have about 30 days worth in the city. We can get you a little more breathing room. I'll get them cranking.
Anything you can do will help, and it'll boost the spirits for the Berliners to see that we're doing something. Thanks, Kurt.
General Curtis LeMay ordered his troops of C-47s into action, flying food, medicine, and supplies to Berlin. Around the clock, hundreds of planes are quickly loaded in West Germany, filled to capacity with their life-sustaining contents to be flown to the anxiously awaiting West Berliners. Once in Berlin, the planes are unloaded of their precious cargo and sent back on their way to return for more. Each plane is a reminder that West Berlin will remain free. Each day the blockade fails to crush the courageous spirit of the Berliners is another day of triumph. This is the first major operation undertaken by the new United States Air Force. The Air Force has nicknamed this Operation Middles. The Royal Air Force has also participated. participating, they have a different nickname. They call it Operation Planefare. But whatever the name, the point is to get as many Vittles into as many planes as possible and get them into Berlin. Observers are calling it a brave effort, but they're skeptical of just how long airplanes can keep a city of 2.5 million fed.
We started building our operation pretty fast.
More C-47s and British Dakotas and some C-54s.
That's what I got sent over to fly, the C-54. We operated out of Rhein Air Base, and there were other Air Force guys up the route at V-Spot. The British were in the north. At first, we only flew at daylight, but before long, it was around the clock. Planes every 3 minutes or so. It was a team, international. Besides the RAF, there were the French. And while Air Forces took the lead, it was Army soldiers that got the cargo to plane side and German civilians that loaded and unloaded the planes. There were some contract commercial flights, and the Navy pitched in with a couple squadrons. Like I said, it was a team. There weren't a lot of experts. Nobody ever tried anything on this scale before. General Smith, he was our first commander. He got things a little bit organized. I think we used to call it organized chaos. Then General Tunner took over. General Tunner, he was an airlift genius. And you talk about organized, the man was an efficiency expert. He was determined that we were going to do this job, that we were going to build an air bridge to Berlin. He said the people of Berlin were counting on us.
This is Armed Forces Radio News. Yesterday in Berlin, Lord Mayor Ernst Reuter spoke to a huge crowd in front of the Reichstag. He spoke to Berlin, but his words were meant for the world.
We cannot be martyred. We cannot be negotiated. We cannot be sold. Whoever would surrender the city, whoever would surrender the city of Berlin, would surrender the world. More, he would surrender himself. You cannot, you must not forsake us. There is only one possibility for all of us. Stand jointly together until this fight has been won. We have done our duty and we shall continue to do our duty. Peoples of the earth, do your duty as well. Help us during this time that confronts us, not just with the war of planes, but with your steadfast, indestructible commitment on behalf of those ideals that alone can guarantee our future, or indeed secure your own ideals as well. Peoples of this earth, look upon this Berlin and upon the people of Berlin. Be certain of this. We intend to win this battle. And shall win this battle.
Last night, the world responded. Voice of America Radio broadcast a message over and over back to Germany. We have heard your voice, Berliners. We have heard your voice.
This crazy thing seems hopeless. Can we really break a stranglehold like this? Bust a damn blockade. Never been done.
another problem on the horizon. The weather would soon change. The skies would cloud and the temperatures drop. The problem wasn't just flying food and medicine. That was tough enough. But there were other tough problems for Berlin.
Mama, why are things so hard?
It's not easy to explain. You know, in East Center, where your cousins live, the communists tell them where they can go, what they can say, or what they can read. They want to do that to all of us. They think that if they cut off our food and our electricity, we'll give up, and then they can tell us what to do. So they blocked off all the roads into Berlin. They could not blot off the sky. The Americans and the British are flying in food, and the French are helping. It's not going to be easy. But if our friends stick by us, we can get by on less bread. Someday, we'll have more food. But if we give up our freedom, we'll never get it back. Remember what Papa always says. We must be brave. We must be strong.
I'll try. I don't need so much rain. But what will we do for this winter? It scares me more. I wish we had this problem. I wish Papa was so good.
Thank you.
Could we help?
At least one way. Coal. We had to get massive amounts of coal to Berlin. Coal for power. Coal for electricity. Coal for heat. But with no barges and no railroad, how to get it there? Not an easy question.
General LeMay's office. Just a minute, sir. General LeMay, it's General Clay's office again.
General LeMay.
Kurt, have you any planes that can carry coal?
Carry what?
Coal.
I'm sorry, General, but we must have a bad connection. It sounds as if you're asking if we have planes for carrying coal.
That's what I said. Coal.
Hell yes, General. The Air Force can deliver anything. Right.
A new challenge for us. Coal. The first idea was to airdrop it. All that did was turn coal into powder. Then someone came up with the idea of stacking it in duffel bags in the back of airplanes. Now that worked. A C-54 would hold a couple hundred. But there was a problem. Coal dust. It collected everywhere, sometimes ankle deep. Some guys flew so much coal, they started wearing miners' helmets.
Give me the RAF.
Wing Commander Charlie speaking.
This is General LeMay. Is the Air Commodore in?
Oh, sir, I'm most dreadfully sorry. He's out flying today.
Oh, will he be back in the office tonight?
Oh, definitely, sir. He will be back this evening. Can I give him a message?
Tell him we need to fly coal to Berlin.
Coal? To Berlin? In His Majesty's aeroplanes? Good heavens. Sir, when he comes in, I'll inform him and I'll get on with it straight away. Good day to you, sir. Crazy Yanks. As if pigs could fly.
Right now, we're doing You know, I sure wish some of the generals and the air commodores were out here hauling and stacking this stuff.
Now, let's not give the troops any more problems.
We flew long days, grabbed a few hours sleep, and went back out to fly again. The harder we worked, the more we began to believe that maybe we could do this. And every time we watched those Berliners unload our airplanes, we got more determined. They knew what each bag of flour stood for. It stood for freedom.
Thank you. sometimes fill my stocking Christmas Day. And though it made my parents sad, because it meant that I'd be bad, it only made my broken heart black as soot. And now I've got this job, can you believe it, wanting this? It brings back memories I lost long ago. I thought that lovely Christmas gift was really punishment enough, but now I'm halfway around the world, calling home. I did inside to all the stuff round by the big plane load. I joined for all their glory and to see lots of action, maybe bombs, grenades, and rockets, but instead I'm hauling flour, milk, and tea.
I remember long ago when cold St. Nicholas Day, my only gifts were several onions and some coal. My grandchildren won't believe, but my Berlin is calling out, and now these blackened lumps would light our tortured soul. This blockade has put our courage to the test. There is no doubt that all Berlin is cold and hungry and in pain. This coal would surely bring some needed light into our lives, and some onions would bring tears, but tears of joy. It's the simple things once gone that are most priceless. Pain and hunger will not drive us from our course. Our Berlin will stake its future on these pilots brave and bold, and a bridge from heart to heart that's made of gold.
I can't believe I'm going to have a plane load full of coal, as I hated it when Rabat sent us out. But these Germans working very long and hard to load my plane have the strength and power of diamonds in themselves.
Yet across the far horizons, help comes flying from the west, flying night and day through corridors of rain. And across Berlin Divide, freedom makes its final stand. For the coal I've prayed and pleaded as a boy.
May the blessings of this divide,
if we only have our reason,
bring you joy and warm that baby.
It will not still the baby's cry.
Burn in your brain beyond our reason,
and this bridge be our salvation.
I will die.
My stomach's hurting.
We'll blast this blockade.
Defiant we stand.
We'll bring Berlin freedom or die.
Bring light to all this darkness. It brings a glorious welcome to freedom and all.
The stretch to call now Berlin right. Will help us carry on the fight. Let's hope these pieces can rebuild our crumbled dreams.
I remember the poets. They entertained themselves and the rest of us, making up little rhymes, sometimes in their position reports. Now, all the airplanes that were eastbound used the call sign Easy. All the westbound were Willies. So you'd hear Easy this or Willie that. Poets, they thought they were pretty funny. We did too, I guess. Sometimes we'd land and say, I heard a good one today.
All big easies from 112, I've a short message to give to you. Stand by one while I give you a fix. We're over full to add 2
6, cruising at 6,000 and in the clear. I sure am mighty glad none of you fellas is here.
Hey, easy 1-2-0, ready to go. Just give me the wood, I make like a boy.
Here comes a Yankee with a blackened soul. I'm headed for Gatto with a load of coal.
Hello, Willie's along the way. Willie 120 has this to say. I'm over Brunswick. 53's the time. 8,500 weather sublime. But my feet are cold and my back is stiff and I'm aging plenty on the old airlift.
Secretary of the Air Force, and
Bob Hope came to see us. He did a big USO show in the hangar on Christmas Eve. It was packed. I can still remember it.
Long ago, a group we called the Air Corps helped win the war.
heard that show.
You know what this is?
Candy.
Yep, candy. That all started when one of the fellows visited Berlin and met a bunch of kids who were watching the airplanes land. He was impressed. They were so interested in what we were carrying, how much flour, how much coal, because they knew what it meant. Came time for him to leave, and he started to walk away. Then he hesitated. He realized they hadn't asked him for anything. Now, he'd flown all over the world, and everywhere he went, kids asked him for candy, but not these Berlin kids. They had more important things on their mind. He wanted to give them something. Put his hand in his pocket. He only had two sticks of gum. Two sticks for about 30 kids. Still, it was something. He tore the two sticks in half and offered them before the children. Oh, the looks of joy on their faces. And there was disappointment on the faces of the kids who didn't get any, but no arguing. No fighting. They unwrapped the pieces of gum, and then there was some conversation. He realized the kids who didn't get any gum were asking for a bit of the wrapper. They sniffed it, and then smiled, imagining the taste of the gum. Kids made happy by a bit of paper that smelled like gum. What he could have done with 30 pieces of gum. And he had an idea. Why not airdrop some gum or some chocolate too? He told him he would on his next trip to Berlin. And he winged his wings on final approach so they'd know it was him. And that's what he did. He had no way of knowing how popular it would become.
Peter, what does your letter say? Dear Uncle Wiggly Wings, I have included directions to my house because I have seen your candy drops, but I'm not doing so well, can't run very fast, so I don't get any candy. After takeoff, fly along the canal to the Second Highway Bridge, turn right one block. I live in the Bondau House on the corner. I'll be in my backyard every day at 2 o'clock. Drop it there.
We tried. Just about every week we dropped candy in that neighborhood. And just about every week we got a letter from Peter that said, no chocolate yet. He drew us maps. He even told us he'd build us a signal fire so we couldn't miss it.
Still nothing! I can't believe it! Peter, maybe they don't get our letters. They get them. Give me that, Captain. Dear Uncle Wiggly Wings, you are a pilot. I gave you my address. I drew you a map. I built you a signal fire. How did you guys win the war?
You know what we did?
What?
We mailed some candy to him. Oh, the memories of kids. They were great. I remember watching two little girls walk across the ramp at Temple Hall with their mother. They walked up to two airlift pilots, curtsied, and gave them some flowers. I don't know where they found them. It was the middle of winter, but they had. And they beamed and skipped back across their ramp to their mother. It was a scene repeated often. I got flowers and other gifts. I'll never forget one little girl gave me a
greatest gift she could possibly give, her most cherished, maybe her only real personal possession, a fuzzy little teddy bear. In her school English, she explained it had been her constant companion in the shelters during the bombing raids. She said it had been a great comfort to her during the last battle for Berlin, and she held it out.
Please take my teddy bear. Will Cam pick up him for me?
Seeing her big eyes fill up with tears, I realized that teddy bear was a treasure. I tried not to take it. But though she wanted to keep her bear more than anything in the world, she would not. It was important that the gift be given.
The luck he will bring to you and your friends on the flight to Berlin.
And good luck he did bring. He is a very special bear.
Thank you.
years after the airlift. Just like the city has, I'm glad we could help them.
Thank you.
proud of you, Rachel. I'm proud of all the people who helped with the airlift. It was a huge effort. Over 250,000 flights, almost 5 billion pounds of food and supplies airlifted to Berlin. But there were other numbers. Those who gave their lives. Americans, 39 with the RAF, and there were Germans who lost their lives as well, about a dozen. At the sight of one craft, a small plaque read, two American flyers became victims of the Berlin blockade here. You gave your lives for us. The Berliners of the West Sectors will never forget you. We stand deeply moved on this spot, which has been dedicated by your death. Once, we were enemies, yet you gave your lives for us. And so they did. In the service of peace and for the cause of freedom, about 80 men gave the last full measure of devotion.
Freedom can stand on its own.